Alright, so today I'll be talking about Haskell from a beginner's perspective. Okay, so just to give you guys some background, I started off from Python. I tried 5 times to learn Python, and I only managed to master the basic syntax. Afterwards, my uncle recommended me to learn Haskell through Haskell book. So it's like quite a big jump, I guess. But if you guys are interested, Haskell book is pretty good actually in giving you a idea of how to learn FP. Yeah. So okay, today I'll be going through these following things. These things actually interest me. So the type system in Haskell, there's strong and static types, right? Sorry, the type system is strong and static. So what do I mean by this? For example, you have a function that takes two integers, correct? You only can take two integers in Haskell and you do not have type coercion. So as a result, right, for example, you give it an integer and a string, it does not work because it doesn't coerce the string or the integer into the other type. Okay, you have non-stringness as well. So as a result, you can have like infinite lists, stuff that doesn't get evaluated until it's needed. And you have recursion, pattern matching, and later on I'll be going through like a mini project. Yeah. So okay, yeah, mandatory hello world. Just to show you guys like what a hello world is like in Haskell. Yeah, so it's actually pretty simple. The first line there is actually the type signature. So all it does is that it tells you that this does IO, input output. Okay? The second line is the body of the function. So it just prints hello world to the screen. Yeah, so executing that gives you hello world. Yep. Okay, so I'll just go a bit more into the syntax to give you guys a clearer picture. We have expressions and type signatures, right? So this is like an expression in Haskell. It's like any other language. A equals to 1 plus 2, B is a string, yeah. And you have a type signature as well. So this comes along with the expression itself, right? It gives you a picture of what actually the function can do. So together you get this. Yep. Okay. So yeah, in Haskell you have your conventional types, the string, boolean, integer, int types, and you also have more interesting types like sum and product types and maybe type. Yeah. So actually I'll explain more about this. Yeah, so you can actually define your own types in Haskell, right? And that's something I find very interesting because you can actually create a lot of structure around the data you want to model, okay? So like you can have a system, like a file system that I'll actually show later how I mocked a file system through Haskell. And yeah, you can model many different things. Okay, so sum types. Okay, so sum types, right, they actually show a disjunction between values. So you have your Boolean type, for example. Okay, Boolean type consists of two data constructors, true and false. So a Boolean type, a variable of a Boolean type can only either be true or false. It's not both at the same time. So it shows a disjunction between values. Yeah, but both true and false are of type Boolean. So yeah, here is a synonymous type, human. So like if you can say like a human is either happy or sad. Yeah. So all I'm saying with the deriving sign there, right, is that I'm saying that I'm deriving a EQ instance and a show instance. So EQ instance means that I can show that happy and happy are equivalent, sad and sad are equivalent, happy and sad are not equivalent. Yeah, it's just to show the comparison between these variables. For the show instance, it's for like a visual manifestation of what these are. So if you actually call happy, it's like it shows happy itself, right? Yeah. So actually, I'm just creating two variables here, happy and sad, to show you guys this. So, yeah, I use the main function from earlier. Main is type IO. It does print to screen as well. So you can see it's actually pretty procedural. Like it goes down and it calls each of these like in sequence. So yeah, happy, sad, false. Okay? Yeah, so that's all our product. Like that's all there is. Pretty clear. Okay, so for product type is actually to show like a product of all these different types that you want to show. So for example, here you are modeling an animal, right? So for the sake of it, we just say an animal has maybe like a name, age, limbs, hair, right? Okay, so we just abstract this out. An animal has both a name and an age. Okay. It does not either have a name or an age. So that's what the product type is for. It's like showing a combination of all these, a collection of all these types, right? So it's another form of expressing your data structures also. So yeah, here, if you guys notice, the name, age, limbs, hair, types, they are not actually primitives in Haskell language. So what you can do is actually define them through type synonyms. So if you take a look here, like I'm saying type name is string, so and so forth. As a result, I also can use like the string methods and functions on this data structure as well. Yeah, so, okay, moving on. You have your functions in Haskell. So, you have a normal add function here, right? It takes two arguments, A and B, right? Adds them together, and it's illustrated through the type signature. Yeah, so it takes one and two, and returns an integer, three. Yeah, so if you execute that, you apply add to one and two, you'll get a variable of three. Okay, so just going back a bit, right? For those of you who know a bit of Haskell, you guys may wonder like, hey, isn't like Haskell built on lambda calculus? So how is it that you can actually take in two arguments to one function, right? Because, I mean, in lambda calculus, you only can fit in one argument in, and then you get a result from it. Okay, so this function here seems to take two arguments in, right? So that's something that's really interesting, and that's where we come to carrying, okay? So carrying. So functions in Haskell, they take one argument and return a function or a value, okay? So actually here is the same add function, but what we are doing here is actually showing this carrying that we are doing. You can actually fit one argument in, get another function, and you can fit that another argument, and that will give you actually the ability to have multiple arguments in one function, right? So here, you have the add, you have the add function. By filling just the first value, you are returning it a lambda function that actually can get another value. So you can partially apply this. Yeah, so here is actually the demonstration of it. So you realize that I can just suspend it, like I just apply one variable to it. I'm just applying 5. After that, I'm suspending it in the partial add. I can then apply it again here. Partial at 6, okay, and get a result. Yeah. So this is pretty helpful, like if you want to map certain functions over your data structures, you'll use partial application quite a bit, as I'll show later. So another thing that's pretty powerful in Haskell, right, is pattern matching. So, okay, here you have a constant function. Takes in two arguments and returns the first one. So this is actually made pretty explicit by the underscore there, if you guys see, right? The underscore there tells you that you can actually ignore the second value because it's not needed at the result state. So another example is the say hi function. It takes in a string and actually does matching on it. So if in the case there is a string of word, it does hello word. In the case where it's an empty string, it just prints hello. In the case where it's anything else, as shown by the underscore again, you just print who are you. Yeah, so there's a demonstration there, printing that to screen as well. Yeah, so case expressions actually allow you to actually match against all these different cases versus like using just if and else statements, correct? If you have many cases, right, you wouldn't want to use if and else statements to structure your data. Yeah, so. Okay, so now I'm actually showing a normal length function. In many languages, perhaps you'll use like for loops to implement this, right? But in Haskell, you can actually use recursion to do it. So here is type signature. You're taking a string and you're returning the length of the string in the form of an integer. So the length of an empty string obviously is zero. The length of a string is actually defined like so, okay? So what we are doing here is pattern matching again. We are saying that a list can be split into the head and the rest of it. Okay? The head and the rest of it. So the head, right, is considered like a unit value. Imagine you a string is essentially, right, a list of characters, correct? So because it's a list of characters, we can take out one of the characters. For example, you have a string of ABC. You take out A. A is of length 1, correct? If you look at it that way. B and C are here, okay? So you can convert A to 1 and keep doing this repeatedly. Take out A, take out B, and eventually you are left with an empty list, which then terminates, right? And then your recursion stops. So if you guys are a bit confused, right? Just think of it like a jar, okay? Like you take, if you are taking out objects one by one, you're left with one object in the jar. You take out the last object, you're left with the empty jar, right? You're not left with nothing, you're left with the empty jar. So the empty jar there is converted to 0. And it terminates your recursive call. So I know like you can just use for loops for this. So this is just a demonstration of recursion. And actually I found application in this like in the mini project, which I'll show you guys later. So yeah, so just a bit of backstory. For me, actually I'm working with Node.js now. So like, yeah, I was thinking maybe I can actually sync drive folders to my local drive, then push it up to GitHub again. So that was what I was trying to do. Yeah, like automate this workflow. And what happened was I realized the drive API, they only allow you to download files. Yeah, so you can't download folders. So how do you do that, right? Like how do you actually download a folder through drive? So what you can do actually is to recursively construct your folder in your local drive, right? Yeah, which is what I did in Node.js. And now I'm porting it over to Haskell. So like Haskell is relatively like, I think it's pretty hard to do like side effects because I'm not like at that tier yet. So what I did is was actually to mock a local drive system and also mock Google Drive to show you guys this functionality. Yeah. So importing the relevant modules, I use the state monad. I think it might be a bit of an overkill, but yeah, I just used it. Okay. Yeah, so okay, we are just defining the type structure of the system here. So name, mime type, idents, right? These are all like properties of your drive files. When you guys call the drive API, you guys will get this. Name, mime type, identity. Yeah, and then the file here, right? Just making it explicit, it's like a file name, right? Because if you just use name for this, name is being used at many places in this program. So you want to make it explicit that you're actually referring to the file name itself, okay? And then we'll use this to construct our files later. You have the folder data type as well. So the folder actually, if you look at it abstractly, all it consists of is a name, a list of files, or if it's empty, empty list, a list of folders. Yeah. So actually, if you look at it, right, we're also doing a recursive call here. Okay? We are recursively constructing the data type as well. Yeah. So the following few functions actually just to do so okay, because I didn't want you guys to look at like directory, folder, file, whatever like that. I wanted to create like a tree-like structure. If you guys use like Linux, you guys know tree, right? So I use like the same idea to actually create a structure for the directory. Yep. So this just does the indentation for me. And this is the show instance. That means like the physical manifestation of how the folder looks like in a tree-like structure. Yep. Okay. So. Oh, okay. Yeah. So these are just some mock files for the system folders that I made to play around with. Yeah. Okay. So now adding stuff to the base of the folder. So like in functional programming, usually you want to break your problems down into smaller parts. Like break it down into smaller functions. So that's what we are doing here. Okay, we break it down into like small functions that we can then use and build them together to actually build our bigger functionality. So these two functions here, what they do is they help me install the file to the root of a folder. So for example, you give it like a slash home, right? You just install it to slash home. Okay, even though it's like nested, there's a whole list of stuff, right? You just install it at the root. Okay, same for folder root. You just add it to the root of the folder. Yeah. So, okay, yeah, modifying the folder. So, I mean, if you guys think about it, you guys don't just want to install stuff at the root of your folder, right? You want to install stuff like at a certain path, at a certain relative path. So that's what this function does. It takes in if you look at the second argument here, it takes in a path, a list, which is a list of strings, okay? So this list of strings, right, you go through it recursively alongside, like, alongside with the folder itself. So like, you go down the path of the folder, because your folder have names, right? So you can actually match against that. If you see here, yeah, if you see here, right, I'm extracting the head of the path, right, and matching it again and again to actually go down the folder itself, and then help me construct the path at the place where I want it to be, okay? Yeah, so, yeah, that's what I'm doing here. Okay, yeah. Okay, the new folder root, this is actually just to create the main system drive that I'm going to use later to install the drive files. Yeah, so, okay, here we have a data type for the drive itself. So the drive essentially is just an object, like so. Yeah, sorry, it's an array of target files. Yeah, so they have all these properties that are earlier defined. Yeah, so this will be what we'll be installing. So if you guys notice, right, it actually gives us like a flat file dump, and that's not very practical. Like, you don't want to install it just like flat on your system. You want to install it in like a nested, in preserving the original structure, especially if you have a huge amount of files, right? It's not practical to manually sort it. So, okay, now we have the downloading functions themselves. Yeah, so all it says here, right, is actually you are taking the identity of the file, the ID number of the file, you're feeding it a path, and then the file will actually download to that path there. Okay, oh yeah, and we are not feeding it, if you guys notice, right, we are not feeding it any like a state, okay? So we are not feeding it any state, like we are just like calling this to, and we're not feeding a third argument, which actually takes in the system state. And the reason why you can do this, right, is actually through the state monad. You can actually sequence stuff by binding them, so you don't need to take in the third argument, right? And this means that you don't have to pass the argument from different functions to different functions. Actually, you can structure it more procedurally, okay? More in a more imperative style. So, okay, yeah, because you can't download folders, right? You just construct an empty folder. It's like make drive, okay? Yeah, so it's like make directory. Yeah, so that's what you're doing here. You just make a directory, and then you change the local state. So here is actually where you're changing the local state, right? Here is where, this is where you'll be changing the local state. Okay, so, to actually know what's in your folder itself, right, you have to go and call the drive API to actually check against the folder ID, then as a result, get a list of subfolders or subfiles. Yeah, so that's what we are doing here. Okay, so this is a action sequencer, a sequence map that I used. If you guys notice, if you guys have used map before, right, if you use it on an array, and you apply a function to it, you'll still retain the array, correct? But what we want to do is actually to consolidate all these different actions into the local state, correct? So we don't want a list of states. We want the remaining state behind. So we want to sequence it again and again, and return ourselves to the change state. And so that's what we are doing here, right? Okay. Imagine now you are feeding it like nothing and an empty list. Obviously, you get the original state back. And that's what we are saying here. We'll just return you the original state. If you feed it a function against like a list of things you want to change, right? This here will actually help you sequence your actions and combine them together into one local state. So that's what it's saying here. So here you have your utility function. So these are like your drive API stuff. Like they help you check against your file details. And this is the main downloading function, yeah. So you realize that actually it calls itself recursively here again as well. And you might be wondering like where's the base case, correct? Like how does it terminate? So it's pretty helpful because the get file and get folder, right? If you notice, they used fmap earlier. So fmap actually when it calls onto an empty string, right, it'll become an empty, sorry, when it calls onto like an empty list, it'll just give you an empty list back. Yeah, it won't give you anything else. So as a result, you can use that to terminate your recursive call. Yeah, so, okay. Just to show you guys the final state. So like this is the original folder. Yeah. Okay, and after executing the function, right, this is what we get. Yeah, okay, not able to see the whole thing, but yeah, this is what we get as a result. So we are able to recursively construct the folder in our local system. Yep. Okay. So, okay, yeah, this is a bit of a sidetrack. This is just like some struggles that I face when I try to do it in Node.js. So like, async functions are pretty hard to use recursively. Okay, the reason being is this. So when you try to recursively construct your stuff, right, your things are going to be calling queries async, right? So it's not like sequenced. You have to do it. I haven't thought about how to do it yet, but as a result, you have like too much requests going out to Google. Okay, Google has a hard cap of like 100 MS, something like that. So like, yeah, you end up with a bunch of corrupt files that don't do anything. So as a result, like, yeah, I did like a hard workaround. So like just 100K sleep. Then like every folder, you just sleep 100K. And then, yeah. But if you guys have any ideas, because this solution, right, doesn't scale horizontally. It only scales with depth. So you need to scale horizontally as well with the async calls. Yeah, if you guys have any suggestions, you can let me know as well. Yep. Okay. Oh yeah, so just to end off, right? Yeah, so this is something that actually combines a few concepts from earlier. Your recursion, some product types. Yeah, so this is your list data type, right? Something that's so, that you guys use so often, correct? Like your array. So actually it can be defined recursively. And it is defined recursively in Haskell. Like it's either an empty array or you then construct it. Okay, you take a value, construct it against the empty array again and again until you have an array of things that you can then use. Yeah. So yeah, okay, yeah, that's it. If you guys want free Unity notes, my friend Jimmy there has provided. Yeah, free of charge. Yeah, anyway, yeah, if you guys got any questions, you can ask me. Yeah, go ahead.
What is the